great prize.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, so yeah, we'll speak about equivalence and non-equivalence and particular Lorentz proof couple over optimistic kind of conjectures with the subject. So, first, recall what is the Grothendieck group of varieties over a field. Well, let's say that everything will be over complex numbers. as an abelian group, it is generated by isomorphic classes of varieties, just X. Reduced scheme finite type with a relation that the class of X equals class of Z plus class of X minus Z whenever Z is closed subscheme of X. And it has an obvious structure of a ring. So this is limit to free. So the multiplication is given just by the product of varieties. Obviously it's compatible with this relations. In particular, if you have two varieties, you can. I mean, it can be sometimes it happens that although they are non-isomorphic, the classes are the same. For example, X and X prime are smooth projective rational surfaces. Then the classes are the same only if the card numbers inside. It's very easy to verify. First, let me formally define what I mean by an equivalence of varieties. So, by definition,
What can we know
about that? If X and X prime are smooth projective rational surfaces, I'm sorry, yeah. Surfaces. Yeah. And then the classes are the same if you don't need the Sicard numbers.
How would characteristics?
Are you also complex numbers? Yeah. So by definition, we call two varieties, let's say smooth projective. X and Y are L equivalent if their classes are equal in the localization of the Grothendieck ring of varieties with respect to L, where L is just the class of fine line. So in other words, this means that for some positive n, we have a to the power n times x minus y equals zero just in the Grothendieck ring. Yeah, so there are some interesting situations. This happens, some interesting situations when the classes of X and Y are different in the Grothendieck ring, but they will be the same in localization. These examples were considered, for example, by Kuznetsov and Jenny Schindler. Some some heat resources which are equivalent, but their buses in general are different. And also this paper by Ito, Miura, Akawa, Yeda. Yeah, so it's yeah, there are some non-trivial situations when this happens, and today I will explain I will obtain some negative results in the direction, so there are two conjectures that this air equivalence. That predicted this air equivalence in a number of situations, and both of them turned out to be wrong. So, first, conjecture by Kuibrecht. Yeah, and both of them were modified in the published versions of the papers, so after they were disproved, those are modified conjectures. First one by Kuibrecht, well, it takes equivalence of several statements, but I'm just interested in one implication that suppose that S and S prime are K3 surfaces, which are as a genus, which means that there is a rational Poisson isometry between the second cohomology so this is suppose that such isogeny exists, so this is Poisson isometry, which means an isomorphy for rational Poisson structures which is compatible with the intersection form. Then it was conjectured that S and S prime are equivalent, and another conjecture is by Sasha and Zhenya. Whenever you have derived equivalence, so if dB of x is equivalent to dB of prime, then x and x prime are smooth projective. Then they are equivalent. I'll try to explain why both of them are wrong, this will follow from a very general statements about growth in the group of an additive category, which I was really surprised that it was some new results. Of course, if you want to distinguish two classes in the growth in the group or in the stabilization, you need some material measure, so you need some invariant which will do this, because it's hard to control this ring by itself. Of complex numbers, perhaps the most powerful invariant is the Poisson realization, which is obtained as follows. So first, now I'd like to explain Poisson realization, which is from the Grothendieck degree ring of varieties to the K0 of the additive category of integral Poisson structures. There's an alternative description of this Grothendieck ring of varieties, which is due to Lu Yang and Wiener, and which works on any field of characteristic zero. First, Lu Yang and Wiener So they prove that, well, it's actually an application of Rubik's tradition theorem that there's another description of the same ring, namely, generators are just isomorphic classes of smooth you take only smooth projective varieties. And the relations which you need, well, first, a very important relation is that the Bessel empty set equals zero, and then that whenever you have smooth closed subvariety and X is a smooth projective, you can take. So you can take its blow up, and here if you have exceptional divisor. Okay, let's say D, and D is of course just the projective bundle over Z, representation of the normal bundle to Z, and in this case you impose the relation the class of D. Plus the class of X equals the class of Z plus the class of the blower. So this relation obviously is obviously satisfied in the here in the Grothendieck ring, because just if you subtract so if you take X minus class of X minus class of Z, this will be the class of U. U is the complement of Z, but also the class of the blow up minus the class of the exceptional divisor. This is of course also the class of U, because this complement is the same. If you define the Grothendieck ring like this, of course you have a map from this ring to the Grothendieck ring over. Defined in the monoid way, and it's not hard to show using Rubik's tradition that this is actually just you're getting the same ring. And if you don't propose this relation, then you will get a very strange Matevic measure which assigns to any variety just one. So otherwise you would get such very very strange functional to integer numbers, just which sends the class of every variety to one, because this relation is satisfied. So to avoid such stupid Matevic measures, you just need to impose this additional relation. Using this, this description is much more convenient to work with, in particular, from this. We can easily obtain this Hodge realization, namely, by an integral Hodge structure, I mean of weight. So this category is just the direct sum of categories. Four structures of weight n, all integer n, and this Hodge structure, well, it was mentioned in the previous talk, is just so V is just a finitely generated abelian group plus decomposition of its complexification into the direct sum of PPQ, where P and Q can be negative, VPQ equals VQP conjugate. Actually, we can also impose polarization condition, but it's unnecessary. So we can impose. functional integral polarization, it sends the class of X, where X is smooth projective, the direct sum, just to the sum of classes of H I of X, and we don't need signs here, so we don't need to consider all characteristic such as alternate sum, because we consider this we consider for structures as an additive category, so we ignore the fact that we have short exact sequences. So in this definition, in this general definition, if A is an additive category, so the only relation which we impose here is that a class of V plus class of W equals the class of V plus W. So we don't consider short exact sequences, for this reason, it is not necessary for us to take alternate sum here. To see this that this is well defined, it suffices to consider the situation with the blow-up, and in this situation, in the notation of this diagram, you see that if C is the four-dimension of Z and X, since D is a projective bundle, you get that homology of D is the direct sum of the homology of Z twisted by minus I, where I is from 0 to C minus 1. But also, it's quite standard that the homology of the blow up is also given by the direct sum, so it is the homology of X. This is isomorphism of graded Hodge structures, graded integral Hodge structures. And the homology of the blow-up, you get homology of X itself plus the direct sum over I from y 1 to C minus 1 of again the homology of Z twisted by minus I. And in particular, we see that we have just an isomorphism of homology of D plus the homology of X. It is just isomorphic to the homology of Z plus the homology of the blow-up. So this is isomorphism of graded pure Hodge structures. Which implies that this functional is well defined. So we have this polarization, and remark that if you consider let's say for simplicity, if we consider rational structures. So to define a rational structure, we could take the sum of classes of graded pieces, if we want to compute it directly for some x where x is not necessarily so x is just a finite type. So not necessarily smooth, not necessarily projective. Then you could consider the mixed Hodge structure on the homology, and just consider the sum of classes of graded reinforcements with respect to the weight filtration. On the cohomology, you don't even need this Leung-Bittner description, but for this realization, if you consider of everything over integers and consider the integer, we really need this description which you use on the projective theory. So we have this post realization, and then it actually factors through the realization by A, namely we can immediately check that if you multiply X by L, the class effect by the lattice element, then you're just getting the date twist. So just it gets twisted by minus one. Well, just if you have X smooth projective, then class effect and L is the class effect times T1 minus class effect, so it's just immediate. And this take twist is an odd equivalent of this category of Hodge structures in particular. So
you don't consider it as a graded category, yeah?
Well, I don't need it. So in particular, the functional which I will use is the the map from the localization to the K0 of additive category of integral Hodge structures, which is well defined as we've just seen. I first formulate statements about abelian varieties and K3 surfaces, and then explain the very general statement about additive category, which will imply all of them. So, first, if suppose that A and A prime, well, let's just write equivalent of superscript A. So, suppose that A and A prime are L equivalent, where A and A prime are abelian varieties. If the endomorphism ring of A equals Z, actually it works for some other, instead of C you can take some other rings, but suppose that all endomorphisms are just multiplication by integer numbers, then A is isomorphic to A prime. So if L equivalence class contains some abelian variety whose endomorphic ring is Z, then it's just this L equivalence class consists of one abelian variety. Another statement is that now for any L equivalence class of abelian varieties has only finite and many isomorphic classes. And now statements about K3 surfaces.
Such that class of B equals the class of W,
and endomorphisms of V equal Z. Well, also more general class of rings, but for example, it holds for matrices of some finite matrices n times n over Z n cross n, then V and W are isomorphic objects. So this equality of classes in K0, it means that there exists some object U in A such that V plus U is isomorphic to W plus U. And of course, in general, so this is like just a stable isomorphism between V and W. And of course, in general, stable isomorphism between two objects that doesn't imply that they are isomorphic, so you can find a lot of examples. But it turns out that if you just impose this condition on V, then W is forced to be isomorphic to V. And I mean, the proof is really easy, and I asked a lot of people, do they know this, and can they prove this immediately, and everyone failed, and everyone, including Big Berenson, for example, and each of them asked me how to do this. So it was surprisingly, it was unknown and hard to prove for almost everyone. I'll explain how to do this, which is really easy. You need just to know some notion of Krull-Schmidt category. So by definition, let's use a different letter. B is a Krull-Schmidt category. This means that B is additive. So if B is additive, and for any object B in B, we have a decomposition of B inside of B into the direct sum of V i's, where the endomorphism ring of each V i is local. This immediately implies that, of course, if endomorphism ring is local, then of course this object is decomposable. Otherwise, we would have an endomorphism that will give you different ideals. So this in particular implies that Vi are indecomposable, but also it follows. If B is Krull-Schmidt, then any object has essentially a unique decomposition into indecomposables. So in general, it's not true that an object of category can be decomposed into some of the decomposables, but in this case, it can. It has some decomposition, and it's unique. This means that if you have two decompositions, then the factors are there's bijection between the summons, which corresponding summons are isomorphic, in particular, let's say corollary of the definition and of this observation. It's really not hard to prove. So parallel of this is that if B is Kirch-Schmidt, then K0 of B is the free abelian group generated by isomorphic classes of indecomposable objects in B. Well, this is just so this isomorphism just so if you have any object here, just decompose it into the sum, and because of uniqueness, it defines an element of this free abelian group.
But what is essentially unique?
Well, I just explained that if you have two decompositions, that the summer size isomorphism, which means that there's a bijection between them. So that there is a summer. In particular, if B is Kirch-Schmidt, then equality of classes of two objects, of course, imply that they are isomorphic. So in this case, stable isomorphism is just the same as the usual isomorphism. But of course, such categories, they're not Kirch-Schmidt in this strong sense, just because the ring of integers is not local, but of course it has no non-trivial idempotence. Even in the weak sense, they're still not Kirch-Schmidt. So, for example, you can easily find some orders in the ring of integers of number fields, even already for imaginary quadratic extensions, so that the models, project models, they're not Kirch-Schmidt. So there's no uniqueness of such decompositions. But still, how do we reduce from this abstract category to the Kirch-Schmidt category? And this is done simply by, if you have a category, you can consider its morphism modulo P, where P is a prime number. So just reduction mod P. Well, formally, this means that. Well, formally, if R is just any associative ring, unital with identity, then AR is a category, which is just a tensor product of A and R, and it has the same objects as A, and its morphisms are simply tensored by R.
You tensor over Z.
Over Z, yeah. Tensor product is over Z. And I don't need derived here, so I could actually take derived, but the result, the K0, will be the same. In particular, I will be interested in AFP, where P is a prime number. And another general fact, which immediately follows from the basic theory of algebra, is that if B is K linear, where K is a field, so if homes in this category are finite-dimensional vector spaces over a field, B is Kalerbe complete, which means that each idempotent has an image, this assumption that B of VW, the dimension of K, is finite. Under these conditions, K-linear category with finite dimensional homes can be complete, then B is Kirch-Schmidt. This is essentially obvious. If you take endomorphism of any object, it's finite dimensional algebra, so it has a radical, the motion model radical, it's a direct sum of magic algebra solve some skew fields, finite dimensional skew fields, and so you get this orthogonal direction of Eilenberg bodies, and this gives you this decomposition into direct sum with local endometries. So it's just completely evident. Yeah, but this has a very important corollary for our situation, namely, we can use reductions mod p, and so under our assumptions on p, we see that for any two objects in p, since the class of b equals the class of w, this means that for any prime number, the images well, let's know this projection functor by PR from A to AFP. So this projection, no, projection sub, sub. This projection of B and W, they become isomorphic in A mod P. And now, well, for matrix rings, you need just a bit more sophisticated argument, but it's also easier. But let's assume the situation that endomorphism of B is just the ring of integers. Then you see immediately that, so first, of course, AFP from B to B is just FP, so it's just Z tensor. Because these projections are isomorphic in A mod P, this implies that the same holds for AFP from B from W, and also from W to V, and for AFP from W to itself. So because the subjects are isomorphic, so of course Holmes between any two of them is just FP. This was because of Schmidt, but after we know this, after we know that they are isomorphic in AFP, of course, if endomorphism of one of them is FP, then Holmes between any of two is FP. Yeah. But now, if A is any abelian group, finitely generated, if A is a finitely generated abelian group, and you know that AFP is FP for any prime P, then of course A is just the ring of integers. So in particular, you see that Holmes between from V to W is isomorphic to Holmes from W to V, is isomorphic to Holmes from W to itself, and all of this is Z. In Z you can take generators, so let F from V to W be a generator of this of this cyclic group, and similarly G from W to V also a generator, and then we know that let's take one of the compositions. So GF, G composed with Z, is not equal to 0 mod P for any P, because this object is isomorphic on the P, so this generators, they must be isomorphic. But this means that GF equals plus minus 1 in Z, because only integer numbers, which is not divisible by any prime, is plus minus 1. Which means that this composition, and similarly for the other composition, so both of them So GF is plus minus identity, and FG is plus minus identity, which means that there they give isomorphism between V and W. So from my point of view, it's very easy argument. In particular, this implies the assertion, which is already removed, about abelian varieties. You just apply posteriorization, and so if A is abelian variety, then its endomorphism ring is just the opposite ring of endomorphism of this of its whole structure on the first cohomology. So if you make this assumption, then the first cohomology satisfies our condition in the category of Hodge structures. So now L equivalence between two abelian varieties implies that the first cohomology Hodge structures have the same class in T0. And by this general statement, we see that these Hodge structures are isomorphic, and then from the Hodge structure on H1, you of course reconstruct the abelian variety.
Sorry, you are modifying your Hodge generalization functor by restricting to the first cohomology.
I don't need to modify. If I have if two graded Hodge structures, if they are stably isomorphic, then each of the graded pieces is for each n, its n graded pieces are also stably isomorphic. Because you're adding something else, so the direct sum is isomorphic. So,
but if you ignore the gradient,
you're right that I can restrict to H1. So of course I can take the composition. So if all the pairs have this realization to the whole K0,
but if you restrict to H1, then it will not factor to modularization.
I already have the realization from. Have a method of localization to this,
mm-hmm.
and of course I can go from here to K0 relative of.
Just imagine that in your variety you have first and third cohomology. How you distinguish when you already projected to HS if you don't keep track of the gradient? If you don't consider this category as a graded category, then you just cannot distinguish which piece comes from HH1. From H1 and which is
considered. No, I don't need to consider. It has a structure of the graded category, but I certainly have a functor from HSZ to HSZ1, similarly for any other n.
If the first category is considered as a graded category. But then multiplication by is not an isomorphism.
Sasha, as I said, it is just a direct sum.
Yeah.
It can be considered as additional structure, but I don't need to do it because I have cones only inside each. So there are no forms between different weights.
If you have a canonical morphism, then the Hodge realization is not compatible with the. Does not factor through modularization by L because it shifts the gradient.
Yeah, I know, but if I.
Of course, you know.
If I already constructed somewhere from anything, so suppose that we have anything which maps to here, then I can compose it with this map. So it's just trivial. So you have a functor from the category of pure Hodge structures which has cones only between the same weights.
So I think that there is here a small problem.
No, there is no problem at all. No, it's just completely.
At least in your exposition, there is a small problem.
Well, I don't know. I mean, it's formal, it's clear.
I mean, there are two steps. In one, in one step, you use one assumption, in another step, you use another assumption. That's the problem.
No, but if I only completed one step, if I only have a map from anything to here, so then I don't need any other information. I just can compose it with one more projection. So what else? So explains the statement about 2 abelian varieties, and in particular, this gives example. So suppose that moreover that A is not principally polarizable. Then, in particular, A is not isomorphic to the dual variety, but of course, we know that their characters are equivalent.
From W to
to V. So this means that you have such a retraction. So this FIs give you the map from V to W some power n, and then you get map back from W to power n to V, and this composition will be identity. So it's a stationary formulation. So this is equivalent to the assertion that this ideal is the identity ideal. And this is checked in the same way, namely, just to show how this works. Suppose that I is strictly smaller than numerator sub V, then this means that there exists prime number such that P x non-trivial on the quotient by I.
It's conceptually just like
finiteness of the class group of any order in the number field. So it's not surprising at all. This classical result, actually, using it, you can process the statement, but applying this observation, well, just to be more precise, to be more precise, you reduce the equation to projected models over over the ring homomorphism. So this observation means that so let's just put additive, say of W, that this is direct summons of W to the power n, n greater than zero, and this category is basically equivalent to finitely generated projected models over endomorphisms of W. So this functor basically saves, it sends V to home from W to V. And, well, this is standard. So this finiteness is a statement about projected models over this ring. And then, so finiteness reduces to Jordan's house theorem just by so you can take the quotient by the radical, and if you take care about z torsion, well, you essentially reduce to the case when this ring is an order in the finite dimensional semi-simple algebra, and then just follows from Jordan's house. Yeah, but as you see, we obtained a very general statement about K0 of an additive integer, which is not models over something, over some ring. It's just like Hodge structures, for example, is a huge category, and a priori it's not clear what happens with this stabilized homomorphism. But it turns out that still each stabilized homomorphism has only finitely many isomorphism classes. And of course, this general finiteness implies the finiteness for abelian varieties, because again, as I said, if two abelian varieties are equivalent, then their Hodge structures in the first homology are isomorphic, and then this finiteness just directly follows from the general result on the additive category. And for K3 surfaces, it's just a little bit more complicated, so for K3, global Borelia plus simple manipulations imply that for any so if A is K3 surface, then there are only finitely many K3 surfaces S prime such that their Hodge structures are isomorphic, but not necessarily isometric. So for in Tarelli theorem, we need to reconstruct S. You need to know its Hodge structure with the intersection form, but if you just drop the isometry condition, it's really not hard to show that there are only finite many possibilities for case resources with the same Poisson structure on H2. Well, you just apply this apply Zarkin's theorem that endomorphism of the rational Poisson structure on transcendental cycles is some it's totally real field or complex multiplication field, just imaginary extension of totally real, and then you just play this and you have an order in this field, and you just play this order and this group of invertible elements, which is huge, and you easily obtain this just simple linear algebra, really. So it's not big deal at all.
And for hypercurrent full folds. For hypercurrent full folds, also there is a finite number of elements in the class.
I'm dropping the intersection form, so I'm forgetting the intersection form, and then it's just a little bit more than well, it almost follows from Golden Tarelli, but you need just a little bit playing with linear algebra. And again from this general finite result, you see that. There are finite many case resources in this equivalence class. Also, just not going into details, I'll just mention that if S and S prime are case resources, then L equivalence between them implies that their transcendental cycles are also stably isomorphic in the category of Poisson structures. It just follows from formula, because you have a functor to each Poisson structure, you can assign its transcendental part, its additive functors, and in particular you get it. I'm almost done here. Then if you know that Zarkin's endomorphism field equals Q, which is for generic case resources in this fold, then this implies that their Poisson structures are basically isomorphic, again applying our general theorem for additive categories, because this endomorphism of the integral Poisson structure is just Z. From this you can construct very explicitly a lot of examples of twisted derived equivalent case resources, which are not equivalent. So completely disproves all this naive conjectures. So, and well.
Any questions?
Self a simply connected tree.
I don't.
A simply connected tree.
Also nice. Just like to correct the conjecture so that it's not immediate to this problem.
So how big is the gap?
I think it's
as big as.
I think in general it's completely different relations. So for case resources, indeed, this can be true. This can be true for all case reasons. It's conformed in a lot of cases, but it's not clear at all. But both for D equivalence and for L
equivalence,
I don't think it's true for Columbia trifolds. I mean, it's not that easy to disprove, but still, I think even just using my results on additive category, you can also disprove it for Columbia trifolds as well. As you see, for K3, for example, each D equivalence class contains only finite many surfaces, and each L equivalence class also contains undefined domain. Also for abelian varieties, the same situation, but in general, this is different types of equivalence.
Resume 8 minutes.